Good afternoon, Monica Miller here, Legal Director and Senior Counsel for the American Humanist Association. This is Legal Tuesdays, where I answer your questions about separation of church and state. We will get started with a question from Andrew Norris on Facebook, who says, what is the constitutionality of a church hosting a presidential candidate to conduct a political rally? Specifically, the Dream City Church in Phoenix is hosting a Trump rally today, which was, I think this was submitted in July. I'm sorry, in June. Beside the utter absurdity of Trump presenting himself in a religious context, aren't there laws that would prevent this, or better yet, remove the church's nonprofit status? Yes, that is correct. That is true. The IRS code and the 501c3 rules and the Johnson Amendment that was added to the IRS code in the 50s specifies that the churches and other nonprofit entities cannot use their tax-exempt status to oppose or promote political candidates. Makes perfect sense. What we have seen with some of these churches, and I think this Phoenix church is a good example, is they are trying to evade that sensible requirement vis-a-vis claiming that they are leasing or renting their facilities to President Trump's campaign rather than being the church itself hosting it. They're saying, no, 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 it's just our building. We have leased our property for other causes too. We are completely very vigilant on this issue. We are looking closely at what those churches are claiming versus what they're saying they're doing. The absence of evidence, you know, say a church has ever opened its doors, you know, to lease it to for any sort of outside non-church event, certainly would be relevant, I think, to the IRS in assessing whether to revoke tax exempt status. But unfortunately, there is a difference between what is illegal and what gets enforced and what gets implemented. It's not just enforced, but who gets punished or has their tax exempt status removed. And unfortunately, we've seen over the last decade, really, a lot of churches abuse their C3 status and get away with it. So, you know, it is good to keep an eye on these, report them to us. You know, we can send a letter to the IRS informing them of the situation and hope that they, you know, inquire and do an investigation, but that's about all we can do in certain instances. Like I said, it is something that the churches are claiming that they are leasing their facilities out. And insofar as that's the case and it's not the church entity endorsing or opposing a political candidate, that actually is permissible. But it needs to be certain that it's not a sham. In this case, I suspect it is. And then the other question is from Craig Schaefer, who emailed us using our Legal Tuesday form. How can we stop government officials from referring to God and religion while representing the government and all of the people? It's a good question. It's a little bit broad, but I imagine that the question is contemplating situations where public officials, say, are giving a press conference or are doing something else in the context of their official duties, and in doing so, endorse prayer or make some sort of religious statement, like, we should all be thanking God for X, Y, and Z. In fact, this morning I sent a letter to the Louisiana governor who called for prayer and fasting as some sort of religious exercise that will cure coronavirus. And he said this in the context of a COVID-19 press release or, you know, update for citizens. So it was in the context of his official duties, and therefore I felt a letter was warranted. You know, public officials certainly, as citizens as well, have their own rights and are able to go to church and practice the faith that they subscribe to. But at the same time, they cannot, because of the First Amendment, they cannot use their public office to promote and endorse religion. Yet again, we have sort of an enforcement problem in that a lot of these statements can go unchallenged because no one would have standing. A court would say no one has standing to challenge certain statements because, you know, they weren't harmed by them. So there are hurdles to the statement type of issues that we sometimes see. Some of them, like the one that I responded to this morning, do warrant a letter or even litigation. Others are things that kind of go so far into the gray territory of permissible and impermissible that it's not worth getting involved, especially if it's sort of a one-off comment that doesn't seem like that particular politician is doing frequently. I would say, you know, vote responsibly, vote accordingly. If you find that you're in a district or an area that Your politician is using, you know, his or her power to as a soapbox for religion. I think that certainly voting them out is one strategy. Of course, that's an ideal strategy and one that's not always feasible. Sending letters, petitions, reminding them that there's a growing population of nuns that they represent, a base of constituents that even if the comments fall short of something that's unconstitutional, still marginalize and alienate a large portion of their base. And so even just reminding them that their base includes atheists and agnostics and humanists, and that can maybe go a little way in having them reframe certain things. So that is all I have time for today, but I look forward to talking to you on the next segment of Legal Tuesday.